The Spirit, God's Holy Spirit, told me which way He wanted me to go this morning. So, my wife and I are married 28 years, and today's our anniversary.
Well, not wedding anniversary.
Today's our anniversary of when we met 28 years ago.
When I said you were a sexy hunka man. The first day he heard me say, "You a sexy hunka man," I was shy.
Yeah. I want to give you guys, I want to tell you guys our testimony. And of how, where we were to where God has us today. Only Him. This is a confirmation that John will bear witness to. He doesn't know.
Go by mama.
He doesn't know what I'm talking about yet. The witness and a testimony that he will bear witness to, but he will shortly. I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself. I'm going to tell you how my wife and I met. And I'm going to take you down a road that I'm not proud of.
To hell and back.
To hell. But he took us to hell and brought us back.
More like we went to hell and he brought us back.
And it goes along with what I'm teaching you guys, because I've been trying to get across to you how about, you know, what's on the board right there about how God changed, you know, the beginning of God's calendar would actually begin is Tishri 1, and it starts in September. This is the beginning of a new year. Okay? And that calendar will follow from Adam to Moses, the old covenant calendar. Then God gave a new calendar, which began on Nisan. They call it Nisan, which would actually be our April, May. Okay? So he changed the calendar time because, amazing, the first calendar represented death. And that's why when Adam sinned, we get the fall of the year. The earth, he died, began to die, and the earth died with him. It's going to make sense to you in a minute. So when the second man, Adam, Jesus, whose name means salvation, which is Yeshua, God, at Moses' time, told them to kill a lamb and put it on a door. It was all a picture of Christ to come.
Amen.
You right? You with me? So that when they took the lamb inside the house on the 10th day, they killed it on the 14th, and they came up out of the Red Sea on the 17th, which 17 is resurrection. Jesus, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, rode in on the 10th. He was killed on the 14th, and he was resurrected on the 17th. Now, so you'll understand, these two calendars are exactly the same. And what I'm talking about is that where God made an atonement in the beginning, you know, on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, and Jesus was our Yom Kippur, our atonement, you know, Satan would have been looking for God to make a sacrifice on that time. He would have known. So what God did and told Moses was, it's actually the same feast, the spring feast and the fall feast, and I'm going to get into that. You might not understand what I'm talking about just yet, but you will. But I'm going to show you a physical example of it, how it operates. So Passover and unleavened bread represents an unspotted, blemished lamb. And on the Day of Atonement, which was in the fall, they was required to take an unspotted lamb, right? And make an atonement. Jesus fulfilled the Rosh Hashanah, Yom Kippur, and Feast of Tabernacles, right? He fulfilled it. Although he never died on Yom Kippur. He died in the springtime because God said, listen, you know, where this was the beginning of the month before, but this, think about this. Every time in the fall time they would make a sacrifice, it was called the Day of Atonement. Shh. Very important. Every time they would make a sacrifice on the Day of Atonement, the nation of Israel would all fast to see if God will accept the offering. Avel, be quiet. Today is very important. And normally I don't do that. You guys know that. I say let the kids be the kids.
Right.
But today is very, very important. And you're going to see how important it is. So normally when they would kill that lamb on Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, they all fasted. And they knew if the offering was accepted, if the priest came out of the holy place alive. They would tie a rope on his leg just in case he died. They could pull him out by a rope, right? Amazing. And just as Yom Kippur was the Day of Atonement, the priest had to go in behind a veil to put the blood on the ark for the nation of Israel. Jesus was our atonement, who died, who told Mary, touch me not, for I have yet not ascended to the Father to do what? To put the blood on the mercy seat in heaven. Our atonement. The two feasts are one and the same. It's except where in the fall time, where they used an animal and God forgave the nation, it went right into the dead season. The trees die. It's wintertime. Everything's dead. Right? God had a plan. And Jesus could never die. I mean, Jesus God had a plan for his son to die, but his son brings life. If Jesus would have died in the fall, they would have went into the dead season. Right? Well, what difference was there? But God said, listen, I'm going to change the first month to the seventh month, Tishri and Nisan, I'm just going to take them. And now Tishri is going to become the seventh month. And Nisan, which was the seventh month, is going to become the first month. So what is he saying? It's exactly the same. He just said, it's no different than if you have a birthday. Man, we are in for a ride today, people. If you have a birthday is a birthday, whether you celebrate that birthday this week or next week. A lot of people say, look, we're going to be busy next week. It's really my son's birthday, but my husband's going to be out of town, so we're going to celebrate it this week. Does it change the birthday?
No.
It's 7 days away. Well, these two feasts are 7 months apart. But God did that, number one, so Satan wouldn't know what his plan was to redeem the world. Right? He wouldn't know. So he changed the time. And that's why Satan in Daniel 7 says that he seeks to change the times and seasons on you and me so we won't know when the Lord's going to come and when he's going to return. He's an imitator, right? He was tricked. He wasn't tricked. He was just outsmarted by the one who's full of wisdom. And I'm going to tie that into what I'm talking about today. meaning that, you know, they say physically that you have a birthday, right? A physical birthday. And then when you receive the Lord Jesus Christ in your heart, you're born again.
Amen.
You have now a spiritual birthday, mm-hmm. right? One was physical, one was spiritual. The first one was for the nation of Israel. The second one is for spiritual Israel, you and me, right? You understand how God operates in that, how he operates where Adam had fell in the very beginning. And I don't want to get, but anyway, let me get to where I was going with you guys, because this is a word for today. To tell you a little bit about myself, I'm going to tell you how my wife and I met. The testimony that I'm about to give you, a lot of people walked out the church on and left us for. Because they told me point blank, there's no way I could be under a pastor like that. So I'm going to give you and expose to you my garbage. But I'm not going to gloat in it. Because what's way more powerful, and I'm not going to go into detail. I never give the enemy the glory. But I'm going to, you'll know the road that my wife and I walked down from when we met 28 years ago to where we at right now. I was raised in a non-denominational, or actually an Assembly of God church my whole life, basically, from an Assembly of God church to a non-denominational church, full gospel church. I don't ever not remember being in church, push, pull, or drag, twice on Sunday, every Wednesday, in every event we were there. I'm one of seven in the house, brothers and sisters, and my mom was a spiritual powerhouse in our house. She's the one that gave us our spiritual upbringing. My dad taught me how to be a man and work. But the spiritual authority, or I'll say the spiritual head in our house, was my mom. You guys had seen some things, and mom made us go to church, all seven of us, kicking and screaming, and I'd cause fights between my mom and dad so I didn't have to go. My dad loved Jesus. My dad is saved and went to heaven. And but as far as, you know, my mom, I'm 46 years old, and my mom's been saved 46 years. So I don't remember not being in church, ever. My mom was a Bible school, taught Bible school, and, you know, and did all kind of things for the kids while we were young. We'd do flashcard memorization, you know, and learned all about Jesus, but never knew him. Never knew him. I never really met him till I was about 30 years old. Is when I met him. My life changed at 30. I got married young. I met my wife today, 28 years ago, September 3rd, 28 years ago, in a daiquiri shop.
Yep.
I was not supposed to be in the daiquiri shop, and if Mama would have known, I'd have been in trouble. You know. So after work, it was about, you know, I got off of work. I was a meat cutter for Schwegman's and went right next door to the daiquiri shop and just to shoot pool and stuff like that. And my wife, her name is Tammy Thompson Schubert. I was playing pool with a friend of mine, and she had put her quarters on, her and her friend had put her quarters on our pool table. And
actually a different table. I saw you were there.
Yeah, we was at different tables. And she had walked up behind me and put her head on my shoulder and whispered in my ear, "Don't you know you a sexy hunk of man?" I was like, man. And I turned around and see this, you know, this blonde-haired, blue-eyed beauty. And I'm like, son. Really. I got to meet her that night, and you know, we went to another little place, but
you left the part out why I said that.
Why did you say that?
Because there was some influence of alcohol beverages in my system. And I used to put put rollers, you know, back in the day you set your hair, you know, and put makeup on with my mom, because he was a meat cutter at Schwegman's. And as soon as we'd walk in the door, my mom's here too, she can testify to that. As soon as we'd get in there, I'd start asking her if she needed pork chops, rump roast, ground meat. But actually, believe it or not, was too shy to talk to him. So I had liquid courage that night, I'm just saying.
Yeah, I don't think I was drinking, I don't remember.
No.
Mama's here, no. But anyway.
He wasn't.
So anyway, the following week, we had planned to go out on a date, and I wound up, we was gonna meet at this place at the lakefront, Bart's, and I might get a little mixed up. She'll probably keep me straight. And
you're right, so far.
We was gonna meet there, and
it was Labor Day weekend, just like now.
So, right. So I went out there to Bart's, and, you know, I couldn't find her. So I was mad. I wound up getting into a fight and, you know, all kind of stuff, craziness. But anyway, the following week we hooked up. And we went out on our first date, kind of, to say. And during a date, I wasn't feeling right. I was kind of sick. You know, I wasn't feeling good. It was a Saturday, so I told Tammy, I said, Tammy, which is promise, and you're going to hear, I'm going to bring you through it, because it's very important to what I'm going to say. I said, you know, Tammy, I ain't feeling good. You know, she's thinking it's a shove-off, a blow-off, you know, but really I wasn't feeling good. So it was a Saturday night. I went home. I'm not feeling good. Mama gets all the kids up in the morning to go to church, right? So, you know, I told Mom, I ain't feeling good. She's like, well, if you don't come to church, you ain't going nowhere. I'm 18 years old, right? Yeah, and
But Mama's mama.
That's right. So we go to church, and I'm in church, you know. So this would actually be tomorrow, 28 years ago, or actually a couple of weeks from now. I'm in church, and I got my head down on my arms like this, and I'm sleeping. And Mama, you know, knocks my arms out from underneath me, and I like to fall on the floor. And when I picked up and looked at her, she went, oh my God, my eyes were all yellow. They were jaundiced. I had hepatitis.
Oh, no.
And she said, let's go. She's seen it, you know, and we went out of church, and I was a meat cutter, and I was cutting bad pork, or cutting pork, and I cut myself, had to get stitches, and, you know, that's where they believe it come from. So anyway, you know, I go to the doctor, and the doctor wants to know, you know, now Mama's right there next to me. you know, he asks me, do you do drugs? Do you have any tattoos? And no, I don't have none of that kind of stuff. Have you kissed anybody lately? I'm like, oh my God. And he looks at me, and Mama's right there. I'm like, I am in serious trouble. Because Mama don't know yet. I never took a girlfriend home. She don't take no girlfriend home to Mama unless she's a Christian girl, right? So I said, yeah, I have, you know. And so I...
Mama sits up in the chair.
And yeah, she's like, who? Oh yeah, you can believe it. So now, you know, I got this disease or whatever it is, and I'm thinking, oh my God, now the doctor's got to call
me.
Her, but it's got to get in touch with my mother-in-law back here, Betty. So Betty now, you know, finds out what's going on and, you know, goes and talks to you and what?
Well, she came in the room and I was sleeping, and the way she woke me up was something from a movie scene. So I'm thinking, oh my God, he got in a bad accident and he died. Because she's like, Tammy, wake up. I have something very important to tell you about Robbie. And I mean, I wake up out of a dead sleep. I'm like, oh my God, is he dead? Did he get in the accident? Did he? And then when she told me he had hepatitis, I was like, oh, that's all. Okay. You know? And so that's when she told me I had to, my aunt was a nurse, so at a pediatrician's office, so I had to go get a shot of a mixture, because at this point they didn't know what type of hepatitis just yet he had, because, you know, there's A, B, so I had to get the shot, and that was the only way that I could see him. And he's thinking I didn't want to see him because...
So anyway,
of the hepatitis.
The doctor tells me I got to be quarantined for 6 weeks, and this is my first 9 weeks of high school. It just started. I mean, high school just opened up. It's my senior year. And, you know, I'm going to miss my first 9 weeks of school. And I had to be quarantined. I couldn't be with anybody. I was separated. You know, my clothes had to be washed separate. Well, the good thing was,
everybody in your house had to go get the shots.
Right.
And stuff.
Everybody had to get the shots and all of that. And I'm thinking, this girl ain't going to have nothing, want to have nothing to do with me. And, you know, and I was like, I was in lust. You heard what I said?
Yeah.
I wasn't in love. I was in lust.
I was in love. In a little lust, so, but I was in love.
So was I at 10 years old.
Yeah.
So,
and Jason loved me too.
So I get a knock at the door, and, you know, my mom, you know, tells me, you know, my dad tells me somebody's at the door. I don't remember who, and I walk to the door, and she's standing at the door with a rose, you know, and she went and got the shot so she could be with me, you know. I was like, wow, yeah, quarantine like this for 6 weeks, yeah, this is good, you know. But so, you know, like I said, I was in lust, you know, ain't no two way. I was 18 years old, most 18 years old. You know, and so anyway, now my mom meets her, and I know it ain't gonna be good. Well, back then I knew it wasn't gonna be good. So naturally, you know, my mom says, you know, Tammy, you want to come to church with me Wednesday night? You know,
I was born and raised. I was born and raised Catholic, and they were going to a non-denominational full gospel church.
So, you know, I'm thinking, oh, great, you know, mom's taking her to church, you know. So I can't go, so they go to church Wednesday night, and what happens?
Well, actually, his memory's a little off there, because he expected his mom to ask me to go to church. He actually thought that was a good thing, because he didn't think, in his so compassionate, concerning way for myself, that I would get saved.
Right.
But he was thinking it was a positive thing, because now I was in with mom.
That's
because
right.
I agreed to go to church.
Right.
He didn't expect me to come back saved after
right.
a praise and worship service on a Wednesday. All I did was cry the entire service. And I remember turning and looking at his mom and going, why am I crying so much? And she said, honey, that's the Holy Spirit. I said, I like it. Ooh, and I'm just crying. So at the end, they gave an altar call, and I remember feeling like I was on fire, like my body was just covered in Bengay inside and out. That's how I felt. And she could see it, because she said they gave an altar call at the end, and I wanted to go up, but you know, when everything's new to you, you don't know what's going on. I was scared. And so she said, do you want to go up? And I said, yes. And she said, okay, come on, I'll come with you. And so I went up and I got saved. And then we went back to the house, and you tell the rest, because it's cute, your version.
Well, she comes back to the house, and she's, you know, all excited, you know, about how she's saved now. And I'm like, ugh. Because, you know, that's
the heathen girl.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, I'm like, oh, you know, the chances are none now. You know what I mean? This, yeah. I'm just being honest, you know. And but anyway, you know, it was 6 weeks from right there we was married. We got married 6 weeks later. We was married on November 11th, 1988.
I need to say something now.
Yes, Mom. What you want to say?
I could talk loud. Given the filming,
It wasn't under my approval, because I wasn't asked. I was told.
Right.
I was told his age, and I was told that he didn't have to have permission. So that's how they got married so young. Mama had no say.
I didn't know that.
So
because she was always just so sweet and just loving, and her and his older sister Missy, they helped my mom and stuff with the wedding and stuff like that. Like, I had no clue. I actually found that out one day when we were giving a testimony. Years later, I had no clue that they had that conversation.
So I remember sitting down talking to my daddy, and I told him what I was doing, and I told him, yeah, I told my daddy, and he said, son, he said, you made your bed, you're gonna lay in it, you know. So we had a wedding. We got married at her grandmother's house, Mama Palmez, and November 11th began our adventure of hell, son.
Amen.
We got married, and my wife was really possessive in a massive way.
Insecure.
Very, very insecure. So that insecurity was, and man, I was into hunting and, you know, all kind of stuff. So I give you, for instance, the first place we get into, I go duck hunting after we moved in and we married and stuff like that. I go duck hunting, and I told her, you know, if I get home late or something like that, don't worry. You know, sometimes the water goes out in the marsh and I can't, you know, and
no.
That ain't right?
No.
Oh, okay.
No, what he told me was, because I mean, my dad had gone on a few hunting trips, but my family's not hunters, so I didn't know what to expect. But he told me, he said, if I'm ever not back an hour after dark, something happened. So he'd always tell me where he was going hunting, what area, you know, in case something happened, and that's what I was told.
So anyway, I wound up coming in. I got stuck out there. The water went down.
Yeah.
I was gone for, you know, a good bit. Well, when I got home,
I was freaked out.
She was freaked out, you know, and she had no trust, you know. So when I tell you, sling the pots at me and
throw
the frying pans, and it was crazy. So long story short, the marriage, I'd be sitting down, and if I didn't turn my head when a Spearmint gum commercial came on and a girl was standing there in a bikini, you know, or a bathing suit or one piece, it didn't matter. It was a fight. I mean, and
extremely insecure.
I mean, when I tell you a fight, I go upstairs in the townhouse, put my pillow up against the tub, and put my foot up against the bathroom door, and she's beating on a door, you know. So it was, you know, so when you get married, there's a lot of there was a lot of garbage, a lot of bags that we carry we don't know, you know. Mm-hmm. So anyway, it tore us apart. After 6 months of the marriage, I was ready for a divorce. I said, you know, it's done. We'll come to find out she's pregnant, you know, and Chloe comes.
God's ordained time.
So the next 3 years, I just went off the deep end. I began to bartend, and you know, I was running around with women all over the place.
Well, it started with, you had the choice. You were made to go to church, you felt like, and then you got to the point where you were like, he got to the point where if he didn't want to go to church, he didn't go to church. Because he was always told. So he kind of went crazy with the freedom is what happened, you know, but not in a good way.
So things happen, you know. I was in the world. Fooled around with drugs, you know, and you know, the women were there, and I mean, it was bad. I left my wife it was a 3-year period. I left, the longest I left it was 15 months, but I really wasn't there for years. You know, I was in a relationship, in affairs. I was a mess, you know, really just, so anyway, you know, that period of our life goes on, and, you know, we are now all going to get a divorce. You know, it's over and it's done.
Can I say something?
Yes.
It was basically, the whole separation part of it was a 3-year process. But what he would do is, see, you can walk away from God, but God will not leave you. And he, you know, I don't know how it is here in Mississippi, but in Louisiana, if we both would have showed up at a judge's office and said, yeah, we've been separated for 6 months, they would start the divorce proceeding. You didn't have to legally be separated, then legally divorce. You just had to agree that, yes, it's been 6 months, we've been separated, and then they start the divorce proceedings, which doesn't take long, if there's no, you know, fighting going back and forth. And he knew that, but you see, we would get to that 5 months and 3 weeks, because the first 15 months of the separation, after he was gone a couple months, I said, you know what, if he can do it, I can do it too. So I went back to the world as well. And like he said, without giving Satan glory, you guys know what goes on in the world. Well, that's what went on for 15 months. I got tired of sinning after 15 months. I really did. And I was actually getting ready to go out with a girlfriend of mine who was also backslidden in her walk, his cousin, went to the same church and everything. And I was on my way to go pick her up. Well, periodically the Lord would use, you know how churches will have like the billboards and they'll either have like a saying or a scripture or something like that on it. Well, a couple times I felt like the Lord was using that to speak to me. Well, I was just at the point where I was tired, you know, but I was angry, you know, at the Lord as well. And so I'm on my way to go pick up my friend. And I said, you know what? I said, I could feel it. I could actually feel a spirit in the car. Now, I mean, I'm living out full out for the world, you know. And I could feel the spirit of the Lord in there. And boy, I just toughened up. And I remember it like it was yesterday. And I out loud, I said, I'm not looking at that billboard. Because in my spirit, I knew he was getting ready to speak something to me. I had to pass two churches. There was Danielle Park, and then there was Dove Park. And they were right across the street from each other, and they both had big signs right there. And they would put, you know, scriptures and stuff like that on it, instead of using it for like announcements, you know. So I'm driving and I'm the whole way there, I'm telling the Lord, I'm not looking, you can do what you want, I ain't looking. Well, guess what? I looked, and it said something to the effect of it was simple, like, come home, all is forgiven, daddy loves you, I miss you, dad. And I was like, I broke. I lost it. Went past the sign, first U-turn, turned around, went home, called my friend. I said, I'm tired of sinning. I'm going back to church. I'm not coming to get you. And then that's when I started standing in the gap for our marriage. That's when I let God, you know, get a hold of me. And but at that point, now that had been almost 15 months of him and I, you know, out there in the world, and we'd be together and we wouldn't be together, you know. Well, then I started going after the Lord. And he knew, though, the law in Louisiana. So what he would do, and he knew that I wouldn't lie, because now I'm trying to live for the Lord and do right. So he knew that if we had reconciled even for a day, he knew I wasn't going to stand before a judge and say, yes, we've been separated 6 months, start the divorce proceedings. So when it was 5 months and 3 weeks, there was 1 week left before, and I would set up the appointment with an attorney, and the whole time tell him, I would say, have you made up your mind? Do you want to come home? I don't want to do this. I just want you, but I can't live like this anymore. And when it gets to 5 months and 3 weeks, he would come home. And then he'd stay a week, maybe less, and leave. So I'd have to start the whole 6 months. But what it was doing was his flesh and his spirit were warring with each other, because he knew what was right, but
his flesh wanted what it wanted, you know? So it was a way for him to buy time, is what it was. So once we got to that point.
You know, brother, not just promise, you know, because I was there the entire time. I was glued to my brother's hip. She turned into Ruth. She turned into clinging to mom. Mm-hmm. And by her clinging to mom, I mean it was in so much prayer. Mm-hmm. And I was always there, even when Robbie wasn't living there. I was always at the house. Tammy would have things to go do. I was watching Chloe. I'm talking, I'm 11, 12, 13, 14 years old.
He rose up as the man of the house. He surely did.
So.
Yeah.
During that time, you know, I was bartending. I was in the world. I mean, and when I tell you we got in some knockdown, drag-out fights, I mean, now, you gotta...
when we were both out there the first 15
years. I was on Bourbon Street, you know, and with all the women, wound up running into her. You know, she just beat the heck out of me right there in front of a cop, and he wouldn't do nothing. I mean, it really got crazy.
My daddy was a policeman.
You know, just to give you a little, you know... girls that I was seeing, you know, God was bringing, you know, across her path. I couldn't hide anything, you know. And
you know, you're jumping back into when I was the 15 months when I was
right.
After.
Well, I'm just giving them a. So anyway,
well, I wasn't serving the Lord in the nightclub beating people.
No,
is what I'm saying.
Right. No.
Let's just get that straight.
That was all the anger part that you go through, and
when I was watching Chloe.
You know, you go through all of this stuff, but you know what? Inside of me, I knew. You know, I knew what I was doing was wrong. But you know, I was trying to feel something that, you know, it wasn't going to happen.
Only God could.
Yeah. You know, no matter how much I drank or how many women I was with or drug and stuff like that. I was sitting in the ballroom one day when the Lord just kind of opened my eyes up to some things when my life really began to change. And I was looking around in the ballroom. And I knew everybody, you know, I was a bartender. And I'm like, wow, you know, this one's going through a divorce, that one's divorced, this one's going, this one is sleeping with that one, he slept with her and her. And I started looking at everybody in a bar. And I knew all of their lives and all of their hurts and all of their pain, everything. And I'm like, man, what am I doing, you know? What am I doing? And it was a war, you know? I wasn't happy, you know? And then I got, like she said, I got tired of sinning. It doesn't matter, you know, how many women you have, how many beers, how much drugs.
How much money.
It isn't where you find your happiness.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
You know, you're not gonna be fulfilled in it. And to show you how far our marriage went, I was actually in this, you know, this woman's house, and I wouldn't call her a woman. She was, you know, a girl or a woman. My wife just walked inside the house.
Calmly.
Inside the house and came straight into the bedroom. And I was laying on a bed. And she told the woman and her daughter that was in there the scripture that the Lord had given her from Hosea, that God was faithful, that he was going to bring me back to her. And all she was doing basically was wasting.
Trying to save her heartache because she was going to get hurt.
She was wasting her time, and she said, I'm here to save your heart because my husband is coming back to me. That's how far we went.
Turned around, walked out.
And turned around and walked out the door. Now, you can imagine where I was at. I was like, you know, my wife told me, you know, when she was, you know, becoming, God was transforming her into, you know, the woman that God had called her to be through much pain. You know, she told me, you know, toward the end, and I was at the end of myself, she said, you know, I don't care who you've been with, I don't care if you've been with somebody tonight, my bed is always open, come home to me. And, you know, I was convicted more by the Holy Spirit, but blown away by how God was using her, and I knew that her life changed. I mean, to even be able to say something like that is not human. It's not, you know, in the flesh, no. You know.
Something he mentioned, but I just kind of want to go a little in depth on. You know, you can apply this to your life and anything that you're going through, whether, you know, it's what we went through or it's a health issue, finance, other relationships. You know, you can't keep your eyes on the circumstances around you.
Amen.
You have to keep your eyes on God and His Word and His promises. Because my circumstances and everything around me was telling me opposite of what God told me. And God told me, because His Word says in Hosea 11:11, I'll bring them home again. This is a promise from the Lord. But the very thing that was promised to me would look me in the eye and tell me, I love you as the mother of my child, of my daughter, but I'm not in love with you. And I don't love you as a wife. And through much pain, and I mean, that's hurtful, you know, I would look at him and I would say, you love me, you just don't know it yet. And the reason being was, it didn't matter. Did it hurt the things he said to me? Absolutely. But in it, I knew God, creator of the universe, who holds everything in the palm of his hand, said, what God has joined together, let no man tear asunder, or woman, or certain kind of women, let me just say. But you know, and so I had to stand on God's promises, no matter what he or anybody else told me, you know, because I knew God was faithful. And God shows you how to fight. If you immerse yourself in his word and you trust him, he'll lead you. He'll set you free from whatever it is that you're dealing with.
Right.
He will give you the strength, because it's only in his strength. It's not through your own strength. And he'll show you how to fight. And for instance, he had mentioned how God would always let me find out what was going on in his life. Not because God was a big tattletale, but because God wanted to show me what I needed to pray against and what I needed to war.
That's right.
And, you know, sometimes we go through things and you think, oh, really, God, come on. You know, I mean, here I am with Chloe driving down Judge Perez. Chloe's 4 years old. And it's summertime, it's hot, my car breaks down. So I got to pull over, and I mean, we break down like in an area where it was like the oil refinery. So it was a long walk before I could even get to even my grand. The closest I was to my grandmother's house on Munster. And so I got to get my purse and Chloe's little school bag thing she had, and you know. She had like a little toys, and it was kind of like a diaper bag type thing. So I'm carrying all this stuff. I'm on busy Judge Perez, you know. It stinks by the refinery bad, you know. I'm holding Chloe's hand, and we walking along the side of the road. And so I said, well, Chloe, she probably don't remember this. I'm like, well, Chloe, okay, you start. Let's sing. So, you know, we walking down the road, and she's singing, I may never march on the enemy, shoot the artillery, ride in the cavalry. So we marching, you know, like soldiers. I'm like, well, you know, Lord, you're going to take care of it. Just send somebody. And that was my prayer. Soon as I said it, a car pulls over, and the car looked familiar to me. I'm like, I know that car. So I kind of walk up carefully, and I look. It's a girl that was a year ahead of me that I went to Holy Angels with. So I was like, oh, thank you, Jesus, because I'm not just going to get in the car with anybody, you know. So I get in the car, and I'm like, oh, girl, I'm so glad to see you. I said, I don't remember your name. I know we went to Holy Angels together. So we introduce each other, and
We get in the car, and she's driving me to my grandmother's house. And I told her, when I introduced myself, I said, well, you knew me as Tammy Thompson, but I'm Tammy Schubert. And she turned, she looked at me, and she said, are you related to Robbie Schubert? And I said, yeah, I am. How do you know Robbie? It was wisdom. The way she asked me, I knew something was up. So I didn't say it was my husband. I said, yeah, I am. How do you know Robbie? Oh, that's my boyfriend. That's who I'm dating. I said, really? No kidding. Me too. That's my husband. She like turned white as a ghost. But I wasn't ugly to her. It wasn't her fault, you know. I don't know what she was told, you know. So, but I did tell her before I got out, he's coming back. He's going to be back. And you're going to get hurt. So the best thing you could do is just leave now before you get too invested, you know. And then got out the car. And it wasn't that God was a big tattletale. It wasn't for me to so-called lay hands on her. It was so that I could pray, you know, and that I could fight and know how I needed to war. And God will show you that, you know, if you stay in his word and let him lead you. He shows you. That was the whole reason so many numerous times that God did stuff like that, to show me things that was going on, you know. And initially I would think, man, really, Lord, come on. Everything I'm going through, my car's going to break down. But had my car not broke down, that wouldn't have happened, and I wouldn't have known how to war. So he does order our footsteps, no matter what you're going through, no matter what your circumstances look like. There's always a purpose, you know.
So that didn't happen just one time. No. I mean, there was...
numerous.
There was numerous girlfriends that she that God brought her way, that, you know, it's going to be revealed, you know. It's going to be revealed. That's all I can tell you. But anyway, you know, there was a war going on inside of me that, you know,
because you saw God's hand moving too, you knew it was God.
Yeah, absolutely, I knew it was the Lord. But anyway, there was a war that was going on inside me that was like, man, Lord, you know, just kind of speed it up a little bit. We come to a point in our marriage where my mom had moved up here in 1994, and, you know, we were not doing good. Married in 88, now it's 94. My mom and dad had bought a house up here. My dad asked if I would, you know, I'd just come up here to help renovate it, you know, my brother and I and stuff. And, you know, we came up here, and my mom asked me to go to church, and, you know, I was doing what I wanted at the time, and I said, ain't no way I'm going to church. So I wound up going to church, and at church, we met these people that, you know, hey, we got an apartment. Are you moving up here? I'm like, no way, can't do it, you know, and this and that. So on my way home, I began to speak to the Lord, and this is in 1995. I said, Lord, you know, if you want to restore this marriage, you know, you know, you got to get me out of Chalmette. And this girl in church had just told me that, you know, an apartment came available, that all I needed was $700 to move in it. So I go home and...
But at this time, we had reconciled.
Right.
That was after you...
Right. We reconciled. We're reconciled. And I'm home, but I'm not right. I'm still right. Running around doing what I want to do. So I told the Lord, if you want to get this straight, you got to get me out of Chalmette. You know, that's just too much history. And so I go home, and my wife's standing at the mailbox, and she's got a check, you know. And she said, man, I don't know what this check's about. I pull up in a driveway. She's at the mailbox. She pulls out this check, and she's looking at it. She's got this, you know, kind of confounded look on her face. She said, somebody sent us a check for $700.
I said, so, I feel it's from the Lord for something, not knowing what he prayed.
So, April of 1995, we moved up here, and that began. I wasn't healed by no means. It was the beginning of our healing, of beginning to. But I still had a lot I was tied to. There was, you know, this woman that I thought about continually. I couldn't get her out of my head. You know, the enemy always used. we were going to church, you know, and we went to this marriage life group. Pete and Dee Romano had a life group, and I'm like, you know what? I ain't going, but we wound up going. And one of the things in this life group, this marriage life group, was about, you know, Pete said, you know, in his teaching that, you know, you have to be totally 100% open with your wife and your husband. If you're battling something, as much as it would hurt them, they need to know. My brother came up here this morning and said something that he's battling inside of him, when he got it out of him, that released him.
Satan don't have a hold.
Because now Satan didn't have a hold. Well, this one individual that I was battling, I knew was going to rip her heart out, son. Because she done confronted this girl numerous times. And, you know, that's what the enemy was using, to draw me back. And so we had this marriage life group, and as the life group went on, you know, I came home. And I said, you know, the teaching we went over tonight, you know, and I'll tell you another thing, and my mother-in-law is sitting right here. Before we, you know, when we reconciled, I'm going to tell you something now. I missed probably one of the biggest parts. My wife, God had spoke to her and said, told her it was all right to divorce me. It's the first time I knew it. I knew it within me.
He was giving me the choice.
He gave her the choice. And so when all of this went down with the money coming and all of that, it was, I knew it was, God was finished. And it was really now up to her. And there comes a time when you get to that point, you know, you can divorce over adultery, you know. But I felt, I knew right then that if I allowed this to happen, I was done. My life would never be the same.
You felt like you were going to miss out on the
I was going to miss had,
which you didn't know what it was.
I've always heard people prophesy or just talk and say, man, God is going to use you in a mighty way and all that. I don't know what how to say it or explain it to you, but other than in my spirit, I knew this was it. There was no more games, no more playing around. It was over. And
before you go further, and it was at that point where I felt like, he's right, God basically told me, it's your choice. Either way, I'm going to bless you. Either way, it's your choice. And I remember sitting there crying, saying, but is it your perfect will or is it your permissible will? Mm-hmm. And I knew within my spirit his perfect will was for me to stay, but he didn't tell me I had to. He told me either way he was going to bless me. And I said, I want your perfect will. And that's why we didn't divorce.
So when I knew the divorce was about to happen, we was only a day away from it, one day from the divorce, final. And when I came to her and said, would she move with me back up to Mississippi? Her mom told her, if you go back with him, you're not welcome in my house anymore. You know, don't ever come back. Because I had left her so many times.
They had to watch me and Chloe.
They had to watch, you know, them living out of garbage bags, going back and forth to my mother-in-law's house. And, you know, I was just running around out there, you know.
It was tough love because they wanted what was best for me. They were tired of seeing me hurt.
But I want to tell you, though, you know, it wasn't a good time for me. I was so, because of the way that I was raised, the Spirit never left me alone.
Amen.
And I sought for happiness every possible way that I could get it. But I knew about Jesus and didn't know him. Man. So when I came, when we reconciled and came back, and we moved into an apartment, you know, God brought us to a church called Resurrection Life.
Right.
And I needed it bad.
Because Brother Hickman, tell him Brother Hickman's motto for the church was.
He said, Brother Hickman's motto said that the church was for the beat, the battered, the broken, and the bruised.
And the bored.
And the bored, you know. And the state that I was in, you know, and that's how I got in this life group, you know.
We were all of those things.
Yeah, we was. So anyway, we go to the life group, and one thing I know is I have to confess to my wife that, you know, I can't get this woman out of my head that I keep running and having an affair with. You know, it's, you know, the enemy will all show you all, you know, well, this woman will do all of this for you, but your wife won't do this for you, you know? And it's lies.
Yes, it is. Mm-hmm. Amen.
It's all lies. It's a fairy tale of, you know, there's no responsibility, there's no children, there's, you know, and you're just living like teenagers, you know, doing what you want. And it's not until, you know, the reality of if I married that girl or another girl, you know, it'd be the same thing. Because, you know, I don't care if you, you know, I'm going to tell you women this, you know, for a man, it doesn't, you know, a man could have the finest woman in the world. Say she's number one rated out of the whole entire world, and she belongs, you know, you marry her. That man will still fool around on that woman, and she could be perfect in body, in every kind of way, shape, or form, because flesh will always be tempted by something else. Because why? Because a woman can't fulfill you. A drink, a drug, or anything like that.
Come on.
And love is not, you know, love is being committed to the person that God has called you to be committed to. And that's hard because it's two different minds and two different bodies thinking differently. And that's why Paul says that, you know, that marriage is tough and it's hard. You know, and a lot of people, even when they get saved, you know, they got this awesome feeling with the Lord, and then shortly later they're gone. Because, you know, it's an emotion. Yeah. I used to be up and down and up and down in the Lord and up and down, and that's how they knew me. On fire for Jesus and in a ball having a beer, you know.
It was all about feeling, not depth.
And that's, you know, and that's where I began to learn commitment. No matter, you know, and it takes Jesus Christ in relationship to do that. So, amen. I came home after this, you know, life group meeting we had on marriage, and I told her what I was battling and who I was battling with. And I looked at my wife on the floor. I only seen her cry one other time, like I saw her cry that night. When I tell you it looked like somebody ripped the guts out of her, I mean, she was devastated.
Fetal position.
Fetal position, called up on the ground. Why, you know? But it was the beginning.
Yep.
I got off of me, you know, what the enemy was holding me captive to, and then that was when God began the healing process in her and in me, you know. And from that point on.
And our families, too.
Oh, yeah.
They were all, everybody, your side, my side, everybody
not,
was hurt.
Yeah, and you know, I'm glad you said that, because divorce, when I tell you it rips everything apart, it rips everything apart. Mm-hmm. There is no good divorce. The kids, all it is, it's devastation.
Amen.
You know, it's devastation in so many ways. because of when we really get down to the nuts and bolts of it, it goes back to, you know, what I wanted and what I wasn't supposedly, well, she ain't doing this or he ain't doing that. And, you know, and because of your choice that we make, it destroys everything, right? So the healing process begins. And it was in this time where God really began to, I began to seek the Lord, and he began to open and show me the word like he's never showed it to me before. I told the Lord when I came back after hearing all the messages preached and sermons out there, everyone you can ever think about salvation, and every other sermon preached, probably a million, maybe. I know a few thousands for sure. I told the Lord, if this is all there is to you, I don't want it. I don't want it.
There's got to be more.
There's got to be more. That's when God said, he told me, I used to read books about the Bible. I knew the scriptures, you know, and the Lord told me, he said, lay down the books and get my word. And when I got in his word is when my whole life, I don't even know how to begin to explain it to you, when God began to blow my doors off, son, and show me things and reveal things to me in his word that was absolutely mind-blowing. And in that process, he took a husband and a wife who has both been into drinking and adultery on both sides, both parts, multiple, numerous times, to raise us up as pastors of a church.
Praise God.
And that's where we stand today, and where our, you know, just a short part of our testimony comes from. Now, I want to connect some dots for you real quick. Yes.
Not only that, just the husband and wife, but the healing that it brought forth through both sides of the family as well. You know, my mom back there loves him like it's her own son. You know, she loves me like I'm her own daughter, you know. And it's just all because of allowing God to just heal, you know. I mean, he really has done some amazing things within the whole entire family through that journey to hell and back.
So, you ain't heard the best part. During this process, my wife had sold her wedding ring, her wedding band. And
so we needed some diapers and a coat.
You know, I had worked for it at this jewelry store. So anyway, you know, she had sold her wedding band. So she didn't have a wedding band for 20 years. Okay. And so the Lord spoke to me one day. This is when my life is really, I mean, we're going back now to 2000, when was it? 11. In 2011, you know, the same year that God calls us to start pastoring, you know, the Lord, he tells me he wants me to clean the house out. Every bit of it, gut it out, you know.
Well, I had had a hysterectomy, but help you, I was laid up.
Right. So her and I cleaned the whole entire house out, everything, the closets, cleaned everything out. And the only thing that was left was what was in the attic. And she had to have surgery and all this, so she couldn't do it. So now she gets home from surgery. I know this is long, but it's going to tie in a minute.
Amen.
She gets home from surgery. She's sitting down in the chair, and the Lord speaks to me, and he tells me. He says, I want you to now go clean out the high places, which is the attic. So I'm like, all right, Lord, I'll go clean out the attic. So I go climb up in the attic, and I start pulling stuff out the attic, and I start going through boxes, and in these boxes are letters that my wife wrote me when I was crazy. And, you know, I start reading it and seeing the devastation and the hurt really, really for the first time. And, I mean, I am gutted in that attic. I am so ashamed of what I'd done, even though God had forgiven me. But it was the first time that I realized the impact of what I'd done. I got cleaned that whole attic out. Got everything out, threw it away, and I was closing up the attic door, and the Lord said, "You're not finished." I said, "What do you mean I'm not finished?" He said, "I want you to shop vac it." I said, "All right, shop vac it, you know. It's a regular attic. They got a piece of plywood up there and insulation all around, you know. They got some mice turds up there, okay?" He said, "Clean. I want it clean." And it represents your mind, the high places. So I went and got a shop vac. I stuck that shop vac, started sucking everything up, and I stuck that shop vac up underneath there. And up underneath the board, and I was shop vacing under that. And when I pulled that shop vac out, in the top of that shop vac, there was a piece of paper about this long, folded over, and it was on top of the round part of the... It was on top of the shop vac. The shop vac was running, and it was shaking like that to get sucked in. And when I went to hit it with my hand, the Lord spoke to me. He said, "No." Man, I knew I was in for something, but I had no idea. My wife had pawned that her ring because she needed money, and she had worked at a jewelry shop at this time. When I picked that piece of paper up and unfolded it, it was a jewelry receipt from where she worked, from the time when she pawned her ring. I mean, could you even, we done moved from Chalmette up there, tell me to shop back it, and that jewelry receipt is underneath the board?
From like 15 years ago.
From 15 years prior? Caught, if it would have got sucked up in the shop vac, I'd have never saw it. The Lord's right then, when I opened that thing up, all I could do was cry. The Lord told me right there, "I want you to remarry your wife. And I want you to have the ring recreated and remade, because this time it's going to mean something." When I was up there, I had no...
15 years after all the healing and everything.
Huh? Right. Little did I know, I was up there and the Lord spoke a date to me, May 14th. I said, "May 14th. And I'm like, "Lord, May 14th, what are you talking about, May 14th? I go downstairs. She's in the chair. She can't get up because she's caught, you know. And I'm like, "You have no idea what God's doing right now. You have no idea what he's saying and what he's doing." And she's like, "What? What is he telling you?" I was crying.
He's like, I'm so sorry. I'm like, "What? It's okay."
You know.
What's going on?
So she's sitting in a chair, and this date is in my head, May 14th. And when I touch the TV, I turn the TV on. God is my witness. When I touch the TV, boom, it came up the History Channel. And on May 14th, 1948, Israel was born again, became a new nation.
Wow.
I'm like, "Oh my God." I'm like, "May 14th, the Lord said, I want you to remarry your wife on May 14th.
Now check this out. I want to connect some stuff for you. We were married in the fall of the year, and God said, now I want you to get married in the springtime. You see what's happening? I'm like, so long story short, I find a picture when my wife is holding Chloe when she was a baby, and she's holding her hand like this, and you know, you could see the ring. So the jeweler looked at it with his eye thing, and he said, I can make it for you. I can do it. So little did she know, you know, God told me to have a surprise wedding for her. Now, we were still married. Don't let her know about it. Have the ring remade, and it's all going to be just like Jesus Christ coming for his bride, right? So we go through this, you know, I have the ring remade, inscribed in the ring is Hosea 11:11. And he told me to write inside the ring, I promised. Mm. The word that God gave her from Hosea. Hosea, you know, being a picture of Yeshua, Jesus, Hosea means salvation. It's a picture of God. And the woman is playing the harlot, but it's opposite. I was playing the harlot. Right? The ring's remade, and I remarry her. And one of the biggest things that God, she had no idea, and I ain't going to go into that, but this is where the Lord wanted me to take you guys today. In the process of the Lord, you know, beginning to teach me his word, and you're going to hear it, you know, the things that are just mind-blowing, you know. In the process of him teaching me his word and showing me, you know, all the things he was showing me, I went through probably 15 years of rejection. Now, meaning that, and my mom will bear witness to this, God began to download revelation from his word on me that was like just wow. I would try to share it with people and they didn't want to hear it. I would try to share it with, you know, pastors and all of this, and they didn't want to hear it. They never did want to hear it, because God has his appointed time for everything.
Right.
He didn't allow me to become like somebody else. He was molding me into the person that he wanted me to be, so that he can use not only me, but our family, our marriage, and our testimony to where we were to where we are today.
Amen.
And in this process of this happening, you know, I was just talking to John in a van, and I said, John, you know what, man? I've went through a lot of rejection, you know, because of, you know, things the Lord was showing me. And I said, you know, but I'm going to tell you something. You know, first thing is this, I want to tell you, that I told him, this was Thursday coming home in a van, that, you know, if you can handle correction, then you'll make it.
Yes. Yeah.
If you can handle correction, and I told him, I said, you know, one of the strong points of my brother's walk with the Lord is that he can handle correction. And it was the same thing with me. You know, I could handle correction from the pulpit, from the altar.
That's right.
And I needed it. I said, but you know, John, I was even, you know, scolded for things that I knew the Lord had spoke to me. And, you know, even being right,
that's,
I said it.
That's right.
I'm going to tell you what it is, what it was. I've had a confirmation 2 times this morning already. You know, I had no idea this is the way the Lord wanted me to go today. Had no idea. And this is what the Lord spoke to me, that I was brought in and reprimanded for. I was in praise and worship one day,
and in praise and worship, you know, just out of the blue, the Lord spoke a word to me, and he told me, I want you to tell my people, thus saith the Lord. I'm going to tell you something. I don't say, thus saith the Lord.
Amen.
No, don't.
The word the Lord spoke to me years ago was, thus saith the Lord, and I told John this in a van Thursday, do not divorce. John? I was in praise and worship when the Lord gave me that word, and I went up on the altar. The Lord said, I hate divorce. He told me when I was in praise and worship, and he said, I want you to go up there and I want you to say it from the pulpit. I'm like, there ain't no way I'm saying this. Because
I, in leadership, you were just a member.
I was just a member of the church. I was respected, you know, but, and I went up there and I stood up on the pulpit and I said, you know, the Lord told me to tell you, thus saith the Lord, do not divorce. I got down off the pulpit and I went and sat down. I got a phone call the next day to come into the church office, and I was reprimanded for it. I was reprimanded because I was told that you have no idea the women that we counsel here that are going through hell to be able to come out and say a word like that. Thus saith the Lord, do not divorce. That's really not a good way to put it. Maybe you should have said, you know, maybe the Lord, you know, I feel in my spirit the Lord was saying, thus saith the Lord, do not divorce. And I said, you know, I understand what you're saying. Me and John just had this conversation Thursday. I understand what you're saying. I don't say, thus saith the Lord. You probably have never heard me even say that before.
No.
But the Lord told me to say it. So I had to say it. He said, well, I want to tell you something. Everything that we've been working to do, you've just destroyed. You just undone everything that we did with some women in this church. So I was reprimanded and wasn't allowed to speak again, basically. I wouldn't be handed the mic to give a word from the altar, which, you know, it's not a big deal. The next day, I got a phone call from a girl. What was her name? You remember?
I remember her face. I can't. You wouldn't want to say her name anyway.
Right. Right.
But yes, I remember the call.
I got a phone call the next day from a young girl who was married with, you know, a child, and said, do you know that I went to church that morning? I asked the Lord.
Monday she was going to sign the papers.
The final.
Her final divorce papers. Divorce.
She told me, do you know that today I was going to sign the papers to divorce my husband? I asked the Lord to give me a direct word from him when I went to church that morning. And God used you to save my marriage.
They still married? They have more kids?
They have three kids, are serving the Lord, and are still married today.
Praise God.
Still married today. I felt like, you know, yeah, I didn't really get into a lot of, you know, Wednesday and next week, I'll show you how some of this applies. You can see it changing, the wedding dates and stuff like that.
It's all about changing. That's how my name got changed.
It's how my wife goes by the name of Promise now. I used to be called Robbie, the good guy. My name is Robert Joseph Schubert. I wasn't a good guy. The Lord told me to go by Joseph. He's in the name-changing business. You know, he's good. It's my real name, you know. But anyway, I felt like, you know, I needed to tell you guys that today. I had two confirmations from it. You know,
the importance of letting the Spirit lead you.
Come on.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. Wow. Two confirmations.
Three now.
Wow. Yes, Madge.
Say something. It's not a confirmation of that, but it goes along with your testimony here. Promise was talking about if this just filled me up, it made me cry a little.
This just, you were talking about, you were going down the street and they had Daniel Park on one side and Doug Park on the other. And you asked the Lord for a message.
Right.
And you looked up at the sign. I don't remember what the sign even said. But I was in one of those churches. And the pastor had gotten up and said, we're trying to build a sign in front of the church. And the church, we need X number of dollars. We don't have it to complete. They had put everything up, but they had to have the electricity and everything installed. And they were out of money. And Joe and I really, you know, we gave them the money for the sign. And I never ever knew if that sign really did any good. But your testimony today tells me that you see God uses people in a separate way at the time when you have no idea. How did we ever know that years later we would be in this church and to hear about the wife who got a message from that son? I mean, it's just unreal. It just touched me so bad. I hated to intrude, but I just had to tell you that.
That's awesome. That just adds to the testimony. Who would have known
that you'd be sitting underneath the pastor, huh? But that son...
Wow. You know, I want to, there's nothing out there that's going to bring us and give us what it is that we need other than Jesus. We'll never be content, we'll never be satisfied until we totally, 100% surrender to Him. Amen. And it's hard. It's hard. It takes work. But you can do it.
Yes.
You can do it.
Right.
And I'm telling you,
just trust Him.
It's not the end. It's the beginning.
Yes, it is.
Right.
It's the beginning. Right. Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, I thank you for what you've done in our life, Lord.
Yes.
And I know the lives that are here, Father, you've touched. And you're working on and you're changing, Lord. And we all are testimony because of your goodness. Lord, I thank you, Father. I just pray right now, Lord, that a spirit, that your Spirit, Father, your Holy Spirit, Father, would just bring healing, Lord, in all of our lives, Lord. Father, just empower us, Lord, where we need to be empowered, Father, to do what it is that you've called us to do. Father, you said it wouldn't be easy. And Father, those that are running and still fighting, Lord, break them down, Father. Show them, Lord, there's nothing out there. Lord, as you've helped me and others, Father, help them, Lord. By your helper, Father, the Holy Spirit. I thank you, Lord, for your word that you've given us today, Father. Word of encouragement, Lord. Even if it doesn't seem like encouragement, it's encouraging, Lord.
Yes, because you're faithful, Lord.
Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. And amen.
Let me just...